On the motion for the previous question, the yeas are 35, the nays are 18, and the motion has passed. Now the minority party does have 10 minutes by which they can issue their minority report. Senator, Minority Leader, you wish to recognize Senator from the second, is recognized for the minority report.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, Senate Bill 292 fosters an unwarranted stereotype, blaming people who need help from safety net programs for the circumstances and casting suspicion on them for using illicit drugs. The drug test requirements would be extremely burdensome on families and difficult for the state to manage. Under this bill, applicants would first have to pay for the drug test in advance and wait for reimbursement through their first TANF check. And then after they test negative, they get that check, they get that money back. The families targeted, Mr. President, it is very difficult, sir.
What is?
It is very difficult for me to follow talking going on, sir.
I think people have lost interest, Senator.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. President. Applicants who have to take the test within 48 hours of the state's determining they have to be eligible for TANF, it is not clear how the Department of Human Services could assure who was eligible, when they met the deadline, and the distance to the drug testing site and lack of transportation to make the compliance possible for some. The Department of Family and Children Services eligible workers already have a caseload exceeding 700 per worker. The drug testing requirements would likely add confusion and delays and increase paperwork. State staff would have to process reimbursement for TANF applicants who test negative. Staff would also have to identify accessible drug testing sites and notify applicants and how they would establish policies and implement procedures for testing which individuals are exempt from testing. Very few parents in Georgia receive TANF. Very few parents, my friends, in Georgia receive TANF. Nearly three quarters of children received their TANF are already in the care of other relatives. In September 2011, there were 4,278 Georgia adults who were part of a TANF grant. There were 26,000 children received TANF in a child-only grant. Most were already living with another relative who have taken them into care, usually their grandparents or even their great-grandparents, their aunts, their uncles, or adult siblings. The state treating these Good Samaritans as suspected drug dealers using drugs discouraged them from taking on the responsibility and increasing the number of children in foster care. This bill is more than likely will cost the state more money. The section requiring testing as a condition for the Medicaid eligibility was removed after a physical note showing that the net cost was $3.8 million to $31 million, but the portion requiring drug testing for TANF applicants still remain in the bill. The claims that Florida state saved money from this program before is unsupported by the evidence. Presentation of the presenters of Senate Bill 292 have concluded information apparently from an organization called Foundation for Government Accountability claims Florida saved money during the brief time it operated the program. However, this is not true. This is not true by own Florida's accountability test. Using drug tests to identify people in need of treatment for the use of illicit substances is medically and scientifically unsound. The Georgia Council of Substance Abuse testified before the committee on reasons why this kind of method does not work and is inconsistent with best practices that are much more likely to identify people with problems and to lead to an unsuccessful outcome. Senate Bill 292 is likely to be found unconstitutional, my friends, because it targets individuals for government's mandated suspicious drug test without meeting the requirement that government show a special need for searches. And letters to the committee chair, legislative council outlined that outlined that 292 is most likely subject to unconstitutional challenge. The U.S. District Court for the Middle District of Florida issued preliminary injunctions on unconstitutional grounds against Florida TANF drug test law in October 2011. The case will be heard in the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals. In summary, Senate Bill 292 targets Georgians for drug tests solely because they need help. These are our friends, these are our colleagues, these are our neighbors. And we test them solely because they need help, solely because they are the least of us, solely because they are only trying to get needed food for their families. Senate Bill 292 is wrong. Let's defeat this, and let's do what's right for Georgia and move in a positive direction for a better, stronger Georgia. Thank you. If there are any questions, if there are no questions, Mr. President?
No questions.
I yield the will.
No questions. Questions on the adoption of, do you have a chair recognized, Senator from the 14th, what purpose you rise?
Thank you, Mr. President. This is inquiry of the chair.
State your inquiry.
You have been elected statewide on two different occasions, and you have a thorough knowledge of the geography of the state of Georgia.
That I do.
I have sat here patiently waiting to ask this question of a rural legislator, but it seems to be a battle among urban legislators that I've had no one to ask, so I will ask you this question. Between America's Georgia and Eufaula, Alabama, there is one doctor. Mm-hmm. There's 63 miles, mm-hmm. two-lane roads, five counties. Mm-hmm. There's not a drugstore. There's not a hospital. And there's only one doctor. Mm-hmm. Now, the DFACS office, or as they call it down there, the welfare office, exists in every county. Mm-hmm. And where are these people to go and get these tests? Do they go to the hospital in Eufaula? Or do they go to the hospital in Americas? Or where? I mean, we've got a DFACS office in Preston. We've got a DFACS office in Lumpkin. We've got a DFACS office in Talbotton. We've got a DFACS office in Georgetown. But no drugstores, no hospitals, and only one doctor. Now, who tests and how do they test? And if they show up, is the doctor mandated to just do it for $17?
Senator has great passion for his rural parts of the state. If I recall correctly, he has more unpaved roads in his district than any senator in this body.
And the United States of America.
And the United States of America. By golly, I stand corrected, I can tell you. I don't serve the nation, just Georgia. Read what? Okay, yes. Read the amendment.
Senator Davis of the 22nd offers the following amendment. Amend the Senate Health and Human Services Committee substitute to Senate Bill 292 by inserting to provide for identification cards for TANF recipients after records on line 8 and for other purposes.
Questions on the adoption of amendment number 1 authored by the senator from the 39th. Is there objection? There is objection. All of those in favor, rise, stand, and be counted. Move the yeas and nays. It shall the yeas and nays be sustained. Clearly, 5 having voted. All those in favor of amendment number 1 authored by the senator from the 39th will vote aye. Those opposed, no, and the secretary will unlock the machine. Senator from the 56th, what purpose you rise?
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. President.
State your inquiry.
Isn't it true that this will actually take TANF out of the bill, and I am against this amendment?
I feel confident that the senator knows from which he speaks. I'm sorry. Senator from 39th, state your inquiry.
Isn't it true that we ought to have elected officials run in and get their drug tests just like we're asking TANF benefits, TANF recipients, that this does not take TANF out of the mix? Isn't that true, Mr. President?
Senator has great passion for which he speaks. On the adoption of Amendment Number 1, authored by the Senator from the 39th, the yeas are 23 and the nays are 30, and the amendment has failed. Senator from the 22nd, what purpose you rise?
Parliament inquiry, Mr. President.
State your inquiry.
Mr. President, is it not true that the 1996 Welfare Reform Act authorized but did not require states to impose mandatory drug testing?
I'm sure the senator has great passion and knowledge on the issue.
Mr. President, further inquiry?
And state your inquiry.
I ask for unanimous consent to withdraw my amendment.
Without objection, the amendment will be withdrawn. Question now is on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection agreed in the report of committee which fail to pass the bill? Chairs none, report of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chairs none, main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Help me. Senator from 35th, what purpose you rise?
Mr. President, parliamentary.
State your inquiry.
No. After the conclusion of this vote, I'd like to move to adjourn.
I'll have to recognize you after this vote.
Thank you.
On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 35, the nays are 18, and this bill having CREX constitution majority is therefore passed. Chair recognized, Senator from the 35th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to adjourn.
All those in favor of adjournment, vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. Trust me, if I had my druthers, I would have went ahead and taken that eye. I'm certain it ain't passing. On the motion from the senator from the 35th, who's praying real hard, but the yeas are 14 and the nays are 38. And just like the good senator from the 14th used to say, the same day the farmer prays for rain, the golfer prays for sunshine. Even God Almighty can't please all the people all the time. I can't do it quite like you, Senator, but that's my best rendition. All right. Secretary will read Senate Bill 469.
Senate Bill 469 by Senator Balfour the Ninth and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 6 of Title 34 of the OCGA relating to labor organizations and labor relations and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Insurance and Labor recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senate's Insurance and Labor Committee offers the following substitute to Senate Bill 469, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 6 of Title 34 of the OCGA relating to labor organizations and labor relations, so as to provide that certain provisions prohibiting mass picketing shall apply to certain private residences and for other purposes. Senator of the 54th offers the following amendment to committee substitute 469 by striking the word shall on line 74 and inserting in its place the word may. Senator from the 9th offers the following amendment to committee substitute 469 by deleting lines 106 and 121 and inserting in both places the following section. This code section shall not apply to any collective bargaining agreement and for other purposes. Senator from the 42nd offers the following amendment to substitute 469. At line 101, striking the word annual. At lines 102, striking the words which shall not exceed a period greater than 1 year and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 9th to present the bill. Please give the Senator your attention. Would like to remind the Senators to keep your conversations to a very quiet.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill before us today was brought up in the Insurance and Labor Committee. Senate Bill 469. I'll go through the parts very quickly, answer some questions. I think everyone most likely probably knows how they're going to vote on it. The language in this bill has been legally tested in a number of states. Texas, Mississippi, Alabama, North Carolina, and Tennessee. All those states have found this bill to be constitutional. It's carefully and narrowly tailored. Its contents are neutral so as not to infringe on an individual's rights. It does not apply to picketing of a private residence that is also the place of employment. Section 2 refers to the National Labor Relations Board, which finalized a rule which requires employers to post notices in the workplace informing employees of their right to organize. We have put in this bill, in Section 2, the ability for businesses to put into the up in their board that they can put a sign saying you have a right to not organize. As residents in a right to work state, many Georgia employees may not be aware of this and may not know the fact that they do not have to. Sections 3 and 4 have to do with payroll protection. Under current law, the authorization cannot be revoked for a year. With this bill, a person can join, start paying dues, and at a point in time in the future can decide they don't want to pay the dues anymore, and they can stop paying the dues. There are a couple amendments that I'll just talk about quickly and then answer your questions. I am in favor of amendment number 1 from the senator from the 54th. It just basically changes the verbiage from you must put the sign up to you may put the sign up. Obviously, I'm in favor of amendment number 2, which is my amendment, which takes out a few organizations. Amendment number 3 is an amendment that I'm not in favor of, although the author of that amendment did talk to me about it, and I appreciate that. And we just have a difference of opinion on that amendment. Mr. President, I usually say if there are no questions, I'll yield the well, but I suspect that there are a few questions, so I'll answer a few questions for a few minutes and then leave the well.
Chair recognized, Senator from the 41st. Suggest everybody get your questions in that you need to. This will be a short debate.
Senator Yield?
Yes, sir.
I know the chair doesn't mean that. Senator, in the bill that you presented to us, on line 20, it includes a person engaged in mass picketing. What would you consider mass picketing? 2 people, 100 people?
I think that that term is defined not elsewhere in this bill, but elsewhere in law, and I do not have that in front of me. So I apologize. I do not know the answer to that.
Thanks, Senator. Would you further yield? In line 25, it talks about a person or organization that he or she is affiliated or acting on behalf of. So is it true that your bill would hold organizations that someone may be affiliated to who had no knowledge or active participation in picketing or supporting or enabling someone to picket, you would hold that person responsible simply by the fact that in some manner he's affiliated to the organization?
If a person or organization, if I have a fiduciary responsibility with a company and I act in my fiduciary responsibility, I'm not only liable, but that company is liable as well. And that's exactly what this does.
Thank you, Senator. On the next page, line 27, you talk about these picketers interfering the right to quiet enjoyment of one's life. How do you differentiate for these people working about, picketing about a labor issue, a labor management issue? Evidently, you're concerned about them affecting someone's quiet enjoyment. Why have we not gone further to make sure that personal residences, for instance, aren't picketed by pro or anti-abortion individuals? I mean, we've had a lot of fact people actually killed by some anti-choice individuals, and homes of doctors have been assailed by picketers. Why is that not a concern to you, that the quiet enjoyment of their lives are bothered?
Senator, I'm not familiar with that situation you're referring to. I know of situations where Shepherd's Spinal Clinic was building an expansion of their building. Obviously, I assume, the expansion of their building was done by non-union labor for whatever reason. The unions decide to protest. That's their absolute right. They have the right to protest. They get the right to protest at Shepherd's Spinal Clinic, not at Mr. Shepherd's home, not at his personal home. Even people out in the hall who've come up to me, even labor union people out in the hall who've come up to me and talked to me about this bill, about different parts that they don't like, I haven't had a single labor person that did not say to me, well, I'm not talking about the homes. I kind of don't like that. Maybe it's unofficial, but I really don't like them picketing at people's homes. I don't think that's right. I haven't had a single labor person come up to me and say, well, yeah, you ought to have the right to picket at homes. I've had at least a dozen people, labor union people in the hall, who came up to me not liking other parts of the bills, but on that part of the bill, they're like, yeah, I'm with you on that one.
Just further, Senator, but wouldn't you say that as you and labor bond on that issue, you might also want to look at some other areas where people are picketing individual homes because they don't like the type of products they're selling in the stores, or that they, abortion might be an issue, or other issues that arise that are non-labor related, consider making that part of your bill in the future, Senator.
Senator, if you think that is an issue, I think that's a good bill for you to introduce.
Thank you, Senator. Further yield.
I will yield.
What was the justification for your assessment of penalties at $1,000 per violation and $10,000 per violation for these picketing?
Will you tell me where you're at?
Oh, I'm sorry, lines 43 to line 54. A person who violates section C, it's kind of A of this section, and has previously been enjoined for a violation of subsection A of this code section, is subject to a civil fine of $1,000 for each day of violation. I was just wondering, like in nursing home industry, endangering a life of a child is a $500 fine a day. Where the $1,000 was derived, or what legal, there may be certainly legal examples where $1,000 was appropriate. Just curious.
The numbers come from trying to keep it into a misdemeanor and what the legal limits are. If the example you gave where a child is in your mind too low, and maybe it is too low, again, that's another place for another good bill to raise the fine for endangering a minor. If it's $500 and we think it ought to be $1,000 or $2,000, Senator, I don't disagree with you. Maybe that ought to be higher, and maybe that's a good bill for you to introduce.
Thank you very much, Senator. I appreciate you answering my questions.
Chair recognizes Senator in the 44th for a question.
Thank you very much. Does the Senator yield?
Yes, I do.
Mr. Chairman, I think you probably answered some of this, but I'm really concerned about this, the line 43 that you just talked about a little. And I want to make sure I understand that if I'm picketing, if persons come to me in my district and ask me, tell me they've been discriminated against and they are picketing, and they ask me to join the picket line, which I generally do, you're saying that each violation is $1,000 a day, and if I represent the group that I founded, Concerned Black Citizens Coalition of Clayton County, because they're gonna help them with that, that the organization also is fined $10,000 a day, and then you're gonna turn around and give that money, have the courts collect the money, because it's paid to the courts, and then you're gonna turn around and give that money back to the person that did the discrimination. Senator, do you think that is fair?
I absolutely believe what's in this bill is fair, yes.
Thank you, Senator.
Chair recognizes Senator 36.
Thank you, Mr. President. Does the gentleman yield, Senator yield?
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to direct a question to you regarding the amendment number 2. And you kind of went through that rapidly.
Sure.
The impact of this amendment, could you be specific with us on what the impact is? How does it change the bill?
This amendment basically would say educators and fraternal order of police and those under the Railroad Labor Act would not be subject to the code section, which has to do with this agreement.
And so why would you select out a subset of the workforce and exempt them and leave another subset in? What's the thinking behind that? What's the rationale? What sense does it make?
Well, I haven't seen school teachers picketing at people's homes. I haven't seen the police force picketing at people's homes. I mean, maybe they are, and I don't know about it, but I don't see that.
Now, if the senator will further yield, does the Section 4 doesn't really relate to picketing a residence? It's a sweeping inclusion of the workforce having to do annual written authorization to have a deduction from their wages. That doesn't have anything to do with private residences, does it?
Let me see what section we're in here.
That's Section 4, lines 108 through 121 is where it, is the portion of the bill that you're amending.
Right. Yes, ma'am. That basically we're seeing that these three groups don't have to do an annual renewal of their membership dues. That is correct.
But electricians and plumbers do? What's?
Well, maybe the electricians and plumbers didn't come talk to us enough.
So there is a certain randomness here. Maybe we could just.
Well, I wouldn't say it's random. We had there are people out in the hall that talked to us about bills, and the school teachers came talk to us, and the police force came talk to us, and other folks didn't.
But you were convinced, obviously, that they had a good case to make, strong enough that you would take them out of the bill.
Yes, ma'am, that's correct.
And just a final question, isn't it true that that same circumstance could be equally burdensome to a pipe fitter or someone out at Lockheed working on jet plane engines or any of the array of shops around the state that have members that do have their dues taken out of the wages. Could you be comfortable with an amendment that just took that out of the bill?
Well, it's not an inconvenience to the individual, because the individual, it's an inconvenience to the group or the corporation who has this in place, or to the Gwinnett County Public School System, for instance, that they would have to get an annual renewal each year, or the union that would have to do it. It's really not an inconvenience to the individual. In fact, the purpose of going the other way in here is to suggest that the reason for this section to be in here to begin with is, I think, to a great extent, if someone signs up, they ought to be able to unsign themselves. And also, you know, you can go through a lot of examples in the business community. I have to sign up every year for my health insurance. I have to re-sign up every year for my health insurance. If I'm part of a federal political action committee, I've got to annually re-up that. So there's a lot of examples of right now that you have to do that in the business community, and so that was my purpose of doing that.
Further inquiry, if you'll yield.
Sure.
If we don't re-sign up for our state health benefit plan, we just continue on, we roll over to the next year with the same coverage. That's in black and white print and on electronically. We get that they continue the same level of benefits that we checked the year before, unless they have discontinued those benefits. So I don't think that the analogy, Drew, is good. Doesn't the individual have to then make a yearly re-up so that it does disadvantage the individual, and further that the employer cannot just continue to roll it? I mean, doesn't this create, really, for the business, for the employer and the employee, an inconvenience, to say the least?
You're giving me the arguments of the senator from the 42nd, who I'm sure will speak to those arguments himself. I'm not a member of the state health benefit plan, so I don't disagree with what you're saying. I'm sure it's true. Where I get my health benefits from, I have to re-sign up every year. I'm not a member of the health savings account or the insurance plan or the state retirement plan. I've taken myself out of all of them, so I'm not familiar with that. If you state that's true, I'm sure it is. But where I work, and where many people work in business, plans change. I don't know how you could just keep the same plan, because places where I work and plans I see, they're always changing, and so you have to decide how many deductions you do and so forth, and so you know, it could be a problem, which is why the one senator has this amendment in. But I have not heard from a single business that say they have a problem with it. In fact, the chamber says that most businesses want this. So,
but isn't it true that this has been a common practice? And I can share my own experience as working at a company for 17 years, and once I joined the union, I did not have to continue to fill out paperwork and perform authorizations about a monthly deduction from my payroll check. And that dates back to the 70s. So we're talking about 40 or 50 years of a common practice here in Georgia, and longer than that in other states. I'm just saying, out of my knowledge, here in Georgia for that long. What's the argument for changing it?
The argument for changing it is having the people decide each year whether they want to do it or not.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 54th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the senator yield for a couple of friendly clarification questions on the previous line of questioning?
Yes, sir.
Senator, isn't it true that the language in Section 1 and 2 and really throughout the bill is addressed at situations where we're dealing with labor disputes with collectively bargained entities?
That's correct.
And isn't it further true that entities such as professional associations for educators in Georgia, Fraternal Order of Police, and those identified other than those governed by the Railway Labor Act are not engaging in collective bargaining in Georgia and therefore are not covered by the scope of your bill?
Which is the thank you for that clarification. That is the reason why we've exempted them under two. They're not under the collective bargaining. That is true.
Chair recognized, Senator from 39th. 39th.
Will the senator yield?
Yes, sir.
I just want to ask a question for my edification, because a lot has been made about the private residence part of this bill. But I'm looking at in subsection A, you add private residence to the places. That is, it shall be unlawful on line 20 on page 1, shall be lawful for any person to engage in mass picketing at or near any place, including a private residence. So it's added there to any place. But in subsection C on page 2 on line 31, where the penalties are discussed, that subsection C does not just apply to private residences. Is that correct? It applies to all those places near any place, all those places in subsection A, correct?
The subsection C in starting on line 34, court having the jurisdiction of an action brought under this subsection shall grant injunctional relief if the court finds that any person, union, or organization has engaged or is engaging in any of the conduct prohibited under subsection A of this section, without regard to the existence of any remedy.
Yeah.
So it refers back to A.
Any place. I mean, a private, is it not? Well, I'll let you answer the question.
Are you waiting for me?
Yeah, I'm waiting for your answer.
I apologize. You may want to repeat the question because I thought I answered it. So.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. The fact is, adding private residence on page 20 is really, they're already included in the phrase near any place. Is that not correct?
That is correct.
Okay, so therefore, when subsection C changes subsection A, these are penalties that are being added to any place that a union or other group is protesting. Is that not correct?
Unlawfully protesting, yes.
Yeah. An employer or other person or entity that is the target of an activity prohibited under subsection A of this code may bring an action to enjoy the prohibited activity against an individual or organization affiliated with such individual in the circuit court for the county in which the affected employer, person, or entity is located. So that's not just at a private residence. It is at any location, near any place. Is that not correct?
If it's unlawful, yes.
Okay. That's what thank you for clarifying that.
Thank you very much.
For my edification.
And mine too.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will yield the well.
Chair recognized, Senator from 21st. My purpose, you rise.
Question.
Previous question. There's objection.
I'm a light on.
Senator from 33rd objects. Senator from 39th objects. All in favor?
Mr.
All
President.
Those, yes, State Inquirer.
Is it not true that with one speaker, that being the author of the bill, no matter how much I respect him, to call the previous question after he's presented the bill without letting anyone else, from the minority or majority, speak to it, is quite frankly improper?
I understand, Senator. I understand. The Senator has great passion for which he speaks. But the senator from the 21st has moved. That is before us right now. All those in favor of the motion will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Senator from the 39th, what purpose you rise?
Inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Isn't it true that we are near the end of the day?
We're
near the end of the day doing what we did at the beginning of the day, squashing the ability of the minority party to make comment on an important issue, to take away the First Amendment rights of people in this state. Isn't that true, Mr. President?
The senator has great passion for which he speaks, and I will tell you, it is getting late. Tempers have a tendency to flare late in the evening after we've worked a very, very long day, and we are tired and we are weary. And sometimes when that happens, it is time to take a break, but there may be more action to take. Senator from 36, what purpose
rise? Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Isn't it true that passage of this bill sends a message to hundreds of thousands of Georgians, working people in this state, that we are ready to strip away their relatively few and scant rights to have a voice on the job, to have dignity on the job, to have collective bargaining rights, to have dues check off? Isn't it true that's the message that this bill sends?
Senator has great passion for which he speaks. Senator from 33rd, what purpose do you rise?
Mr. President, I ask unanimous consent that the rules be suspended so that I might take the well on a point of personal privilege for no more than 5 minutes.
That motion would not be in order.
Mr. President, after hearing my friends around the chamber tell me they won't allow me to speak, I doubt it would have passed with unanimous consent anyway. But I'll tell you this, Mr. President, isn't it true it's a dark day in Georgia?
I understand, Senator. Okay, the only issue that is before us right now is the previous question has been ordered, okay? So now we're taking up the bill. All those in favor, excuse me, We have floor amendments. The first floor amendment is authored by the senator from the 54th. Is there objection? Without objection, amendment number one will be adopted. Now the question is on amendment number two, authored by the senator from the 9th and others. Is there objection? Without objection, Amendment 2 is adopted. Now the question comes to Amendment number 3, which is authored by the senator from the 42nd. What purpose does the senator from the 42nd rise? State your inquiry.
Isn't it true, Mr. President, that this amendment would merely allow each business to decide for itself when it would have its reauthorization so that it could do it more often or less often than every year?
I'm confident the senator knows from which he speaks.
Ask one more question.
State your inquiry.
Isn't it also true that if we wanted to avoid another costly government mandate on business, we would support this in order to ensure that businesses can be as hard on labor unions as they would like to be?
The senator is very eloquent. But the question now is on floor amendment number 3. Is there objection? There is objection. All of those in favor of amendment number 3, rise, stand, and be counted. If you're in favor, you move the yeas and nays. Well, how about us voting aye and nay? All right? Vote your machine. Unlock the machine. Thank you. on the passage, or excuse me, on the adoption of the amendment number 3, the yeas are 18 and the nays are 34, and amendment number 3 has failed. Question now is on the adoption of the committee substitute as amended. Is there objection? Without objection, the committee substitute as amended is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection granted? Report to committee, which failed, pass the bill. Chair is none. Report to committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put, or the objection? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Senator from the 35th, what purpose do you rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Isn't it true that today has been a day filled with sexism, gender bias at its worst, partisan politics at its worst, and racism and class warfare? And if this bill now passes, Senate Bill 469, that it will... and if it had passed back in the 60s, then I'd be out picking cotton instead of standing right here in this chamber.
Senator has great passion. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 34, the nays are 18, and SB 469 is therefore adopted. Secretary will read. Got some House bills.
House Bill 985 by Representative Powell, the 29th, and others.
Bills Public Safety.
House Bill 1114 by Representative Setzler.
Judiciary.
House Bill 1119 by Representative Sims of the 169th. House Bill 1120 by Representative Sims of the 169th.
Slow go.
House Bill 1121 by Representative Sims.
Slow go.
House Bill 827 by Representative Hembree, the 67th, and others. Bill to be entitled an act.
Public Safety.
House Bill 851 by
Finance.
House Bill 1051 by Representative Jacobs of the 80th and others.
Transportation.
House Bill 1052 by Representative Jacobs of the
80th. Transportation.
House Bill 534 by Representative Fullerton of the 151st and others. House Bill 861 by Representative Hardin of the 28th and others.
Health and Human Services.
House Bill 1027 by Representative Stevens of the 164th. House Bill 1132 by Representative Dickey.
Regulated Industries.
House Bill 651 by Representative Maxwell, the 17th, and others.
Appropriations.
House Bill 1066 by Representative Williams.
Regulated Industries.
House Bill 1110 by Representative Cooper, the 41st,
Health
and others.
Health and Human Services.
House Bill 1165 by Representative Clark, the 98th,
Finance.
And others. House Bill 681 by Representative Dickerson, of the 95th, and others.
Agriculture.
House Bill 822 by Representative
Health Lynn. And Human Services.
House Bill 940 by Representative Pack, of the 102nd.
Judiciary.
House Bill 946 by Representative Teasley, the 38th, and others.
Banks and financial institutions.
House Bill 1048 by Representative Willard of the 49th.
Judiciary.
House Bill 1089 by Representative Carson, the 43rd.
Slow go general.
Through the order, Mr. President.
You got the pages? Like to recognize our pages. We actually have, if my number's right, 5 pages that have been with us all night. Morgan, Andrew, Natalie, Payton, and Colton. All right. Thank y'all very much for your hard work. All right. Thank y'all. All right. Y'all can just slide on down there. Good. Perfect. There you go. Looking good. We'll get you an ice cream sandwich and a moon pie after this. Chair recognized, Senator from 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to table Senate Bill 87.
Is there objection to tabling SB 87? Without objection, it will be tabled. Chair recognized, Senator from 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to table Senate Bill 299.
Is there objection? Without objection, the bill will be laid on the table. Chair recognized, Senator 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to table Senate Bill 348.
Is there objection? Without objection, it'll be laid on the table. Chair Gnai, Senate Bill 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to table Senate Bill 406.
Is there objection? Without objection, it will be tabled. Chair Gnai, Senate Bill 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to table Senate Bill 465.
Is there objection? Without objection, the bill will be laid on the table. What's the next order of business? Okay. All right, this puts us at the foot of the calendar. Is that what y'all are wanting to do? Secretary will read SR 673.
Senate Resolution 673, Senator Couser of the 46th and others. Resolution making a renewal application to the Congress of the United States to call for a convention for the purposes of proposing an amendment to the Constitution of the United States and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Government Oversight recommends that this resolution do pass.
You'll understand. We read it? SR 673, we read it? Chair Gnai, Senator from the 46th. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I know the evening's late, so I'll be brief with my remarks. This resolution calls for the United States Congress to call a convention to amend the Constitution to add a balanced budget amendment only. We have a financial crisis in our country today. Our national debt is now in excess of $15 trillion. For every dollar of government spending, we're spending another 50 cents in borrowed money. We now owe over $49,000 per citizen in this country in debt, over $138,000 per taxpayer. We're spending over $450 million a year on interest alone and are destroying the foundations of this country. We're going to leave our children and our grandchildren burdened by mountains of debt if we don't deal with this situation now. As you know, this state has a constitutional provision that requires us to live within our means. We must have a balanced budget. And that is true in 49 of the 50 states in this country. There is no reason why the United States Congress shouldn't do the same. But Congress has demonstrated that without a constitutional restriction, it will not balance a budget, will not limit its spending. This resolution is an attempt to amend the Constitution to require that the federal government also operate with a balanced budget. This will apply only in the absence of a national emergency and will require that appropriations for any given year shall not exceed the revenues for that year. Ronald Reagan sought this in his campaign for presidency back in 1980. In fact, we were, I think, only one or two states shy of getting a balanced budget amendment at that time. And I'll remind you that Senator on the 14th may remember back in 1976, the state of Georgia passed an identical resolution calling for a balanced budget on the federal level. And you'll recall at that time, this body and this entire legislature was controlled by the minority party today. This is not a partisan issue, it's a fiscal conservative issue. We need to do this for the soundness of our nation and our children. Article 5 of the Constitution provides two ways to amend the United States Constitution. The first is that Congress can propose an amendment, requires a two-thirds vote of each house, and then it's submitted to the states for ratification from three-fourths of the states. In this case, Congress has failed to act. Part of the provisions of the debt ceiling bill that was passed back in the summer called for Congress to take a vote on this issue before the end of the year. That vote was taken by the House of Representatives in December, and it failed. The other way to amend the United States Constitution is when two-thirds of the legislatures of the states, that would be 34 states, file an application to Congress to call for a convention to propose an amendment to the United States Constitution. There are already 17 states that have filed similar applications for a balanced budget amendment, and I ask that Georgia do that also. I'll point out that this convention held of the states does not amend the Constitution. The convention would only propose amendments to the states, just like Congress proposing an amendment, and it would take three-fourths of the states to ratify such a constitutional amendment. We're asking for one purpose only, for a balanced budget amendment. I don't think any fears of a runaway convention offering other type of amendments are realistic. If any other amendments were offered, they would have to be ratified by the states, and I anticipate that Georgia would have resolutions limiting our delegates to deal only with the balanced budget amendment at such a convention. This is good fiscal conservative policy. It's needed for our country. It's a bipartisan idea. It's been supported by both parties in the past, and I ask for your consideration of this and your favorable vote. In light of the fact that even the minority party tonight has moved that we adjourn, and we seem like we're wrapping up business, Mr. President, I will yield the will.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 33rd. Speak to the bill. Chair recognizes Senator from 48. Speak to the bill.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, the hour is late, and I'll only be in the well for a few minutes, but I wanted to make a brief statement explaining why I intend to vote against the resolution. I believe that Congress should balance the budget. I believe that a balanced budget amendment should be incorporated into the Constitution, but I don't intend to vote for the resolution because I'm not in favor of a constitutional convention, which I do not believe can be confined to the single subject of a balanced budget amendment. And so for that reason and that reason alone, I intend to vote against the resolution. If there are no questions, I'll yield the well.
Senator from the 41st, what purpose you rise?
Mr. President, I believe the senator in the well said if there are no questions, he would yield the well. I did have a question, and I had my light on.
You wish to come speak to the bill?
I wanted to question the senator because he said if there were no questions, he would yield the well. It implied that if there was a question, he was willing to answer it.
Chair recognized Senator from the 41st. The senator has come back to answer questions.
I just ask one question. I appreciate your comments. I have a similar concern about limitation. Let me ask you, on line 19, it says that in the absence, 18, 19, it says in the absence of a national emergency, you know, that we'd have a balanced budget. Don't you feel that is also a subjective matter of whether we have a national emergency considering debt payments, et cetera?
I really can't speak to that. I mean, I do believe that Congress should balance the budget, and I believe that Congress should propose an amendment that incorporates a balanced budget provision into our Constitution. I'm just opposed to this process. And I will draw to the attention of the Senate that 4 years ago, this body unanimously voted to repeal its call for a constitutional convention on the balanced budget amendment and on a half dozen other amendments because of the concern that a constitutional convention could not be confined to a single subject. And I'd be delighted to yield the well if there are no other questions.
Chair recognizes Senator from 32nd.
Senator, do you yield for a clarifying question?
Sure.
Isn't it true that this resolution does not concern a constitutional convention, but only follows the guidelines of Article 5 of the U.S. Constitution about an amendment convention? Isn't that true?
I mean, I'm relying on a letter that Chief Justice Warren Burger wrote, I think, in 19,
88, in which he stated his opinion that you could not confine one of these constitutional conventions to a single subject matter. You know, there are other lawyers. I know that like Justice Berger, you're a member of the bar too, and I'm sure you can get different lawyers to offer different opinions. But but for the concern I've stated, I intend to vote no.
Your light's on, Senator from the 41st. No further questions. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the resolution? All those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 30, the nays are 20, and this bill, Adam Seerek's Constitution majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read SR 766.
Senate Resolution 766 by Senator Hill of the 32nd and others, a resolution urging the United States Congress to adopt and to submit to the states a balanced budget amendment to the United States Constitution to balance our current budget and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Government Oversight recommends that this resolution do pass by substitute. Senate Government Oversight Committee offers the following substitute to Senate Resolution 766, a resolution urging the United States Congress to adopt and to submit to the states a balanced budget amendment to the United States Constitution and for other purposes.
Chair recognized, Senator on the 32nd. Present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. For the sake of time, I'll be brief. I'm not going to restate the statements of the senator from the 46 a few minutes ago relating to the need for the United States government to balance our budget, only to reference and bring your attention to line 10 of the resolution, which sets forth that the budget deficit debt is approximately $14 trillion. Unfortunately, that number has increased since the writing of this legislation, so I'm not going to offer an amendment, but the debt is actually greater than that. But this is simply an urging resolution to Congress, nothing more than an urging resolution to the United States Congress also take action that they're allowed to do under Article 5 that we referenced a few moments ago. And an urging hope Congress could actually pass a balanced budget amendment proposal and send it to the states by early next week. And the measure we passed a few minutes ago would take some time because you need two-thirds. With that, Mr. President, I'll yield the well, and we move on this evening.
You're going to take questions, Senator.
I'll take one question, but otherwise.
Chair recognized, Senator, on 42nd.
Senator, yield.
I do.
Is it not true that when Ronald Reagan took office, this country was the greatest creditor nation in the world? And when Ronald Reagan left office, it was the greatest debtor nation in the world?
The senator knows for what she speaks. I think we're the greatest debtor today. The budget deficit was not even probably one-tenth the size. With that, I'll yield the well. Thank you.
Senator yielded the well. The question is on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? All those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. And Secretary will unlock the machine. On passage of the resolution, the yeas are 36 and the nays are 16. And this resolution, having received requisite constitutional majority, is therefore adopted. Secretary will read SR 848.
Senate Resolution 848 by Senator Tolleson, the 20th, and others. A resolution urging Congress to prohibit the Environmental Protection Agency from further regulating greenhouse gas emissions and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Natural Resources and the Environment recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senate Natural Resources and the Environment Committee offers the following substitute to Senate Resolution 848. Resolution urging Congress to prohibit the Environmental Protection Agency from further regulating greenhouse gas emissions and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes Senator from 20th.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's now 14 minutes past my bedtime. I know y'all are tired and I'm tired. This is an urging resolution to Congress to try to get the EPA to stop trying to regulate the greenhouse gases, and really, let's stop and take a look at what we're doing to ourselves, our nation, our ability to compete, our ability to have energy in this country. And it's Congress's responsibility to fulfill the role of what they were sent up, elected and sent to Washington, D.C. to do, and that's pass legislation that deals with these kind of situations and these issues, whether it's from cap and trade or whatever different facet of air quality and all. And I think it's Congress's responsibility to deal with this. And we need to pull back on the regulatory burdens that are being put across this country on businesses, and has such a negative impact on business and the ability to be able to employ people in this country. So it is just an urgent resolution, but I think it's something that we need to take serious and try to urge Congress to be responsible and take their role and move forward with it. And I would take questions or just yield the will.
No questions, Senator.
Thank you very much.
Questions on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, the committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection green report of the committee which failed to pass the bill? All of those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Senator from the 34th, what purpose you rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Mr. President, how many more urgent resolutions we got this evening? The hour is late.
I could have some editorial comments, but I will keep them to myself. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 34, the nays are 16. And this resolution, after receiving requisite constitutional majority, is therefore adopted. Got some bills to assign.
House Bill 684 by Representative Buckner of the 130.
Natural Resources.
House Bill 685 by Representative Maddox of the 172nd.
Judiciary.
House Bill 1071.
Finance.
House Bill 1093 by Representative Braddock of the 19th and others.
Judiciary.
Through the order, Mr. President.
Are we taking up any more bills? Secretary will read SB 559. All right, 459.
Senate Bill 459 by Senator Schaefer, the 48th, and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 1 of Chapter 3 of Title 46 of the OCGA relating to the generation and distribution of electricity generally and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Regulated Industries and Utilities recommends that this bill do pass. Senator Staten of the 18th offers the following amendment. Amend Senate Bill 459 by deleting may on line 4 and inserting in lieu thereof shall not, by deleting the colon at the end of line 12 and deleting lines 13 through 15 and inserting in lieu thereof the following. By the consumers may elect not to use smart meters of any investor-owned electric light and power company and for other purposes.
Chair recognized, Senator on the 48th, present the bill.
President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I'd asked that Senate Bill 459 be dropped to the foot of the counter. I was worried that we would not get to the foot of the counter, but we are here. And what this legislation does is it simply authorizes the Public Service Commission to allow electric utility consumers to opt out of the smart meter. And it also authorizes the Public Service Commission to regulate the fee that the electric utility would charge that a consumer for opting out of the smart meter. It does not, it doesn't prevent the smart meters from being installed. It doesn't, in its original form, doesn't even require the Public Service Commission to allow an opt-out. It simply authorizes the Public Service Commission to allow an opt-out. And if the Public Service Commission does allow an opt-out program, it does give the PSC the authority to regulate the any extra charge that the utility would make for having to physically inspect the meter. There is an amendment that the Majority Whip and Majority Leader, I think, have offered, and I will let the Majority Whip explain his amendment. But I would the bill came out of the Senate Regulated Industries Committee with a almost unanimous do pass recommendation, and I would urge your favorable consideration of the legislation.
Who's got you? I'm sorry. Read the amendment. You already have? Chair recognized Senator from the 18th. I'm sorry. I've already recognized him. Sorry.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to be quick because of the lateness of the hour. The amendment simply takes away the second part of Senate Bill 459, and that is the part that would allow the PSC to charge a fee for opting out. We have a lot of people who don't want the technology. They don't they're not comfortable with it. They don't want it in their homes, and I don't believe that those individuals should be charged a fee for opting out of the use of the technology. So that's all the amendment does, and I would urge your support for the amendment. And if the amendment passes, the bill. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Wish to ask a question? Chair recognizes the Senator on the 41st for a question.
Yeah. Senator Yield?
Yes.
Senator, have you talked to the utility companies that have to do the work and have to, you know, check the meter if they don't have a smart meter to see how much it costs them or, you know, garnish their support for your amendment?
Senator, it's my assumption that whatever the costs are for monitoring the electricity usage is already there. It's currently in place. They're already doing it. So I don't think they should be charging more if you give them less work to do.
Senator, further yield?
Yes.
Would it be logical to expect that if you had a house with a meter that transmitted information directly to the George Power Company or whoever, utility company, and then did not have a meter that electronically transferred it, and you had a human being go out and check it, that would cost more on that residence than the electronic meter. Is that logical?
Senator, I'll leave the logic of it to your to your discretion as with respect to your interpretation. I would simply say if people choose not to use technology, they shouldn't be penalized for that decision because that's the way it is now.
Thank you, Senator. I appreciate you. We've seen logic in the eye of the beholder tonight, so I appreciate your comments.
Chair recognizes Senator from 36 for a question. 36, your light's on. You wish to ask a question?
Does the senator yield?
Yes.
Are you seeking to just make an effort so that the smart meter technology can be in place, but that there's also a way for an individual to not have to go that route? Is that the pure and simple what the bill does?
Basically, the bill, if I understand it correctly, Senator, would give people the ability to opt out of using that technology, and my amendment would simply not allow the PSC to charge someone an additional fee for opting out.
Now, you're not going to drug test them, are you, if they opt out?
I don't think there's anything to do with that in this bill, Senator.
Thank you.
I yield the well, Mr. President.
Senator has yielded the well. Questions on the adoption of the floor amendment authored by the senator from the 18th. Is there objection? Without objection, floor amendment is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection granted? Porter committee wish to fail to pass the bill. Chair is none. Porter committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put or the objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 36 and the nays are 13, and this resolution is therefore adopted. Does any senator wish to rise on a point of personal privilege? Senator from 33rd is recognized.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I'd like to ask your attention for just 1 minute, if I could. A moment ago, I was denied of the opportunity to state my position on a general bill which can become law in Georgia, without anyone but the author having presented the measure. I don't know what private conversations have been convened amongst you today or through different leaderships. I don't know. I know I didn't have anything to do with it. There are two rules in here, Section 10.10.1.1. No senator shall knowingly circumvent the clear purpose of the intent of Senate rules. I kind of feel like it was close there. I could have asked for a two-thirds vote. I didn't want to be further embarrassed because, quite frankly, ladies and gentlemen, I've been here 32 years. I've invested a third of the century and over half my life. When I was chairman of transportation, I never said to any author that their bill wouldn't be heard. I told him I might beat you, and I'll try my best, but every bill will be heard you ask me for. When I was the governor's floor leader, there were some of you that asked me to put things in the budget or to meet with the governor, and you didn't get anything but help from me. When I was chairman of the Democrats, I made sure that we respected these rules and worked with each other. I represent 165,000 people. Their voice will not be quieted. It would be easy for me to take the well from now on to the end of the session and speak 30 minutes on every single issue. I'm not going to do that. From reception I got, it sounded like I might not ever speak again. I just want to say that if you understood my intention, I was going to speak against the bill, but I was also going to say there was no place for some of the names that were called in the committee the other day that concerned the chairman of the Rules Committee. There's no place for that. He's been my friend 22 years. I've tried to respect you always, and I'm sincerely sorry that I haven't earned yours. Thank you.
Does any other senator wish to rise on a point of personal privilege? Chair recognizes Senator 38th.
Mr. President, colleagues, it is a shame that I come up here and have the same comments that the senator from the 33rd had. I was the last speaker on a bill this morning, actually at 3:25 this afternoon. I was disrespected, my constituency was disrespected, the women of the state of Georgia were disrespected by you not allowing me to talk about an issue. It wasn't Viagra, it was a medical issue with the bill. The disrespect that you have shown me and my colleagues today, I certainly hope will never happen to you again. This is truly a dark day in the history of this Senate, this body, this group, and it's wrong for you as colleagues to silence a colleague, the last person who wanted to speak on the bill. I would not have been up here over 2 or 3 minutes. I had a valid point that you did not want to hear. It's unfair, it's wrong, and we need to learn to govern ourselves and respect each other in this body. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th on a point of personal privilege.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, as I said a short while ago, we've come full circle. We began with the voice of the minority being squashed, and we ended the day with the voice of the minority being squashed. Senate Bill 469 was important to my constituents. I've got 8,000 petitions here from Georgia citizens whose voice was not heard on Senate Bill 469. These are not all petitions from people in my district. There's some folk on here from Mayretta. Is that how you pronounce it? Milledgeville, Jonesboro, Shamley, Dahlonega, Jacksonville, Fitzgerald, Tucker, Thomasville, Soperton. These are Georgia citizens whose voices weren't heard this evening. I think some of them probably are Republicans, some are Democrats. Some are black, some are white. Some are younger, some old, but all of them deserve to be heard. And one way or the other, we will be heard. Those Georgia citizens will be heard. This day we have done, the senator from 33rd as he makes his exit. We love you. We love you, Senator. But this session, we've done it. The senator from the 33rd is right. He said a whole lot of things today. And some of it was spot on. Not all of it, but most of it was spot on. He said we have put guns in the hands of teenagers. We have told Georgians in order to put food on the table, they need to take drug tests. We've done a whole lot of things, but not one thing we've done has prevented a foreclosure. Not one thing that we've done has stopped an eviction. Not one thing we've done today has put a job on the table. Nothing we have done today has talked about, thank you. Nothing that we've done today advances protections on ethics. And that's a bipartisan issue. The senator from the 29th, senator from the 41st, and I believe the senator from the 6th all had ethics legislation. And nothing we have done today ensures our constituents that we're in a better place ethically under the Gold Dome than we would otherwise be. We have squashed debate. We have pressed down the minority. And I hope the majority party is not proud of that. You've gotten what you wanted, but the day of reckoning, as I said at about 10 o'clock this morning, the day of reckoning will come. The people of the state of Georgia deserve to be heard through the mouths of these 56 people that serve in this district. That has not happened today. It's unfortunate for Georgia. It is indeed a dark day for this state. Thank you, Mr. President. I retire from the well.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 44th, on a personal privilege. Senator from the 49th, your light is on. Is there a reason for that? All right, didn't think so.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'll be brief. Because today is the anniversary of Bloody Sunday, March the 7th, 1965, I guess I was most frustrated about all of these bills that have come up, and especially about 469 and the fact that we were not able to voice our opinions on that. And most of you, when you think about Bloody Sunday, you think about the 400 marchers led by the late Reverend Hosea Williams, who was a member of the General Assembly, and Congressman John Lewis now. Most of you think about the Voting Rights Act when you think about that. And most people don't even think about who Edmund Pettus was, a Confederate general, a judge, and a United States senator from Alabama. But the focus on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, why it's historical, is because it deals with the Voting Rights Act, but also deals with marches and mass demonstrations. And because I march and because I believe in it so strongly, I was just real, I guess, upset because we were not able to voice our opinions. The difference in that march, I guess, and the marches we have now, and the march we took up in Forsyth County with Reverend Hosea Williams, is because we had the state troopers there for our protection. There, the state troopers beat them, beat the marchers. That's why it's called Bloody Sunday. And Jimmie Lee Jackson was shot in the stomach, and 8 days later, took him 8 days to die. So because we were not able to voice our opinions and even ask, even come to the well, except I was able to ask the author of the bill if he felt it was fair. But I think in this body, when we talk about crossover day and when we talk about really doing what's best for the citizens of Georgia, I think it's only fair that we allow the senators who represent people in this state to have their voices heard. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes the majority leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the Senate stand in recess until midnight and adjourned until Monday at 10 a.m.
Recess till midnight? What time is it? Oh, we are a little shy of midnight. All right. Stay home until midnight. And any announcements? All right. We'll come back at what time? 10? All right. 10 a.m. on Monday. All of those in favor will say aye. All those opposed, no. That's a weak no. Ayes clearly have it. We stand adjourned.